Hello and welcome to Conversations. Today my guest is the son of a nurse and a coal miner from the valleys of South Wales who grew up to lead the Labour Party through some of its toughest times. He was leader of the opposition against the most formidable post-war Prime Minister, Margaret Thatcher, a one-time man of the left who became a moderniser who transformed his party and paved the way for the electoral success of Tony Blair and the new Labour years. He went on to serve as one of the UK's European commissioners. He is Neil Lord Kinnock. Lord Kinnock, welcome.
Thank you.
Let's start at the beginning of your political life. Some people get their politics from a university seminar, some from experience. Are you one of those who inherited his politics in the valleys?
You could put it like that. It certainly came from the community in which I grew up and the family that I was hugely fortunate to have. It wasn't that they were stridently political, they were socialists, matter-of-factly, and trade unionists. And I learned very, very early on that the only source of strength that we really had was our own diligence and the strength of numbers, of collective action. I was just under 15 when illegally, in terms of the Labour Party rules then, I was permitted to join the Labour Party by our local ward secretary, who was also our county councillor, a marvellous fellow. That's where really my politics, my democratic socialist politics came from. Further inspired, I must say, by the fact that our Member of Parliament was an Irene Bevan, and not only was he worshipped by my family and everybody I knew, but he was the model of how you could mix inspiration and construction.
So what was the culture like in South Wales? Because your father, he came from a big family and a lot of them had had very tough lives, hadn't they? I mean, it was really difficult times with industrial injuries and really hard work for a really long time in a way that probably people starting work now couldn't possibly imagine. Did that influence your culture and your political culture?
Well, people starting work now hopefully will never experience. My father was one of seven surviving children. My grandmother had had 13 pregnancies, of those, nine produced children, seven of whom survived. That was typical. That wasn't in any sense extraordinary. And there was a similar, slightly smaller numbers pattern with my mother's family as well. And amongst those seven children, six were boys, and all but one of them became miners, colliers, like my grandfather, and just about all the men in my family, except for those who were bakers. And of two remained in the pits after the 1930s, the rest were forced to leave, become migrants. And they made their way to ultimately very successful jobs, two in the steel industry, one in electronics. They did all kinds of things. They were in boxing booths, they were wrestlers, they were steel workers, and that's the kind of background. My father stayed in the pit. He loved being a coal miner, and he had a redoubtable reputation as a Stakhanovite, a great producer. He's the kind of generous guy who, as people told me after he died, during the war, when people were kept on in the pits, experienced miners, way past the time they should have been going underground, and had dreadful asthma, product of pneumoconiosis, dermatitis and so on. If they were ill, he'd cut their tonnage and then cut his own. And that's the kind of guy he was. And my mother was a similarly generous spirit.
Your mother was the district nurse,
yes,
wasn't she?
She was. She was a sort of sheriff. She knew everybody, everybody knew her, and she was always immensely smart in her uniform. She was welcomed everywhere she went, but she had a sense of order that was quite remarkable and a real presence. She was quite a woman, highly intelligent, But for the 1926 general strike when she was 16, I think she probably would have gone on to study medicine, despite the awful poverty of her family. They had kept her in school after she'd got a scholarship to the grammar school. But the 1926 general strike came, there was a new baby in the house, and it was simply unsustainable. So she left and undertook nursing training instead. But she was a redoubtable, wonderful woman.
Your parents obviously had a great influence on you.
Yeah.
They obviously worked very hard for you, to give you an opportunity.
Yes.
Was that an opportunity to leave the Valleys, do you think? Or did they want you to stay and be a big figure there?
It never translated itself in those terms, funnily enough. I remember a single conversation of that kind. Their whole emphasis was on my self-fulfillment, what the Americans would call my self-actualization. they would have fallen over if they'd heard that word. And they wanted me to do the best that I could. And at 11, I was immensely promising. I had no difficulty flying into a very, very creamed boys-only grammar school. The only problem was I had to travel about 3 hours a day to get there and back. But it was a highly thought of grammar school. Lloyd George called it the Eton of Wales, as if that was the greatest flattery. And I had a miserable time in school, maybe because I was ginger, I was bullied. And that's where I learned to fight, and where I took some of my politics from, actually, because I've always loathed and sought to fight back against bullies of every description. And I guess it wasn't a bad training ground. I eventually got to like it in the sixth form when I was treated as an adult by good teachers.
And let's just stop for a second, because for all of us who've had a hard time after not doing well at our O-levels, you're a bit of an inspirational story, because you didn't do very well in your O-levels
either. Appallingly badly. I didn't realise until I was actually sitting the O-levels that revision was required. I mean, I eventually collected quite a lot of them, but only after I'd had this real punch between the eyes of getting very good marks in three subjects, which are, of course, utterly useless. So I had to stay on for an extra year and do more O-levels before I was permitted to go into the sixth form.
Would your parents have let you leave school then at that point, do you think?
No. I did everything I could to get out. I applied to the NCB, National Coal Board, for a management traineeship and was accepted. When they discovered that I was going to become someone in the coal mining industry, they went berserk. But you loved being a coal miner. By this time, because of industrial dermatitis, a dreadful disability, he had his hands wrapped for the rest of his life. But he loved being a coal miner. They transferred him because of a dust allergy. They transferred him to the blast furnaces in the Everville Steelworks, which is even more dusty than being underground. Anyway, I said, "Did you loved it?" And he said, "I loved it, but if you went down there, I'd hate it." And they really were very, very resistant, and I knew I was making them miserable, so I didn't do that. They then applied to go to the army, and they said, no, you can be a soldier. By all means, be a soldier. We think it's a fine thing to be a soldier, but do your A-levels first and then make a decision. And I stuck that for a couple of months, and then I applied to join the police force. And when they found out about that, they said, it's a terrific thing. It's absolutely great. But wait until you've done your A-levels, which I did. And then I got it reasonably A-levels, got into university. When I got elected to the Students' Representative Council in my second year, I went home at Easter time, and my mother and father congratulated me. I'd got quite a good result. It was very good. And my father said, taking this politics seriously. And I said, yeah, it's the only way to get things done. He said, I agree with that. You won't be growing a beard, will you? And I said, why the hell not? And he said, because politicians should always have to shave in the morning to look at themselves
in the mirror.
And like a clever dick, I said, oh, what about women? And he looked at me and he said, lipstick. So no chance, even if I had been a revolutionary, of being a bearded one.
Now, you left with a degree, but of course you also met your wife.
Yes.
Glyn is now Lady Kinnock, a formidable politician in her own right. And in those days, you were called the power and the glory.
Yes.
Which was which?
I was the power, she was the glory, and all you had to do was to look at the photograph of us and you'd know which was which. And the title was given to us by a dear, dear, dear friend called John Collins, who's a very active councillor up in his native Preston still. And John wrote a column about us and called us the power and the glory, and it stuck. And of course, mischievous or malevolent people wanted to turn it the other one. She was the power, I was the glory. But that's certainly not how John wrote it in the first place. And, I mean, she was a hugely effective organiser. I really had to win her out of a shyness, an innate shyness. And, of course, when she did find her feet on the platform, she was immensely convincing. Because I remember we had a conversation when she was running to become, after years of me trying to persuade her, and her rebuffs to become an elected politician, because, you know, she really has got the kit. There's no question about that. She's not only articulate and intelligent and very strongly committed, but she's also charming, something I missed out on, but there you are. And I tried, and other people tried, but she always dismissed it while the kids were growing up. When Rachel, our daughter, went off to university. The first weekend after that we were going to see her in Bristol, Glenys announced that she was going to try and secure a nomination to become the member of the European Parliament for South East Wales. And I was so shocked, I really nearly drove off the road. I had to stop. It was so amazing. I was delighted, but I was amazed. And she said to me as we were driving along afterwards, she said, "I'm not sure I can do it, but I'm going to give it a try." And I said, "Of course you can do it." She said, "Well, you know, what about speaking?" And I said, "Well, you've done lots of public speaking." She said, "Yes, but it's not the same. It's nearly all been with friendly audiences. You've spent the last several years teaching seven-year-olds to read. All you've got to do is to treat the world as if it was 7 years of age and take the same attitude and you'll never have any problems." And I mean, she's a born teacher, and it's stood her in good stead, I must say.
How important has she been to your life?
Oh, vital, in all respects. You know, I could give instances of inspiration and consolation. She was largely responsible for bringing up the kids, especially in their teens. I became elected leader of the Labour Party when my son was 13 and my daughter was 11. And obviously I had preoccupations. They always knew, as they've told me since, that I was doing my damnedest to get to a school concert or a football game or a netball game to be there. But I obviously, unavoidably, missed quite a lot. And it was Glenys that provided the absolute rock-solid steadiness, stability, encouragement. And they've turned out to be very, very fine people. So I owe her that. Sorry. I don't know how I would have made it through the death of my parents within 8 days of each other in 1971 if Glenys hadn't been my mainstay and partner, producing Rachel a week after my mother died, which was a wonderful preoccupation. So I guess that eased it.
Was she supportive of your desire to become an MP? Because you were very young, weren't you? We should remind people, you were only 28 when you were elected.
The circumstances were odd in many ways, fortuitous in others. We got married in 1967, and because her job was in Abersachen Grammar School, Roy Jenkins' alma mater.
Didn't he say that was the Eton of Wales, perhaps?
He might have, but it wasn't. And that was her first teaching job. And I was the workers' education tutor organiser for South East Wales. And most of my work was over towards the Cannon Valley, the Rhondda, and westward of that down to Swansea. And we needed to find somewhere that was halfway between them. And the place was Blackwood. And when I turned up there, obviously we transferred our membership of the Labour Party from, as it happened, from Ebbw Vale to what was then Bedwelly. And I thought the MP, about whom I knew little, was a guy in his late 50s. Anyway, he turned out, a very decent man called Harold Finch, to be in his late 60s. And I was sitting there in 1969 as the minutes secretary of the constituency Labour Party executive, taking notes with my pencil of the proceedings. And we came to any other business in January 1969. And Jack Petty, the president, dear old comrade of mine, said, "Is there any other business?" And the MP said, "Yes, Jack, I could send me any other business. I've decided I'm not going to run at the next general election. And if you look at the minute book, you can see where my pencil broke." So immediately after the meeting, some friends who were on the executive and I, young men and women, went down to our usual haunt, the Llanarth Working Men's Club, and Glenys joined us. And I said, "Right, who are we going to run?" And they looked at me and they said, you silly sod. And I said, "Too young." I was 27 then. "Too young," I said. "No, you're not. You got what it takes. We are going to run you." And 6 months later, in the selection meeting, I drew with a veteran of the Spanish Civil War, a guy I would have voted for if I hadn't been running, Lance Rogers, 75 votes each. And we were called in again to make another speech. And I won by 76 to 74 and secured the nomination.
Very young man in the House of Commons. And, of course, this is the pre-television age. So had you actually ever seen the House of Commons or been there before?
I'd been there once for a demonstration and not got in, and once to see Michael Foot shortly after I was selected. He was in the middle of the House of Lords No. 2 bill, campaigning successfully to defeat the government in its proposals to reform the House of Lords in a way that he strongly detested. We had tea and a drink, and that was the only time I'd been in there previously.
How easy did you find it to stand up and make a speech in the Commons chamber?
Difficult, always. But I don't enjoy speaking in any case. Never have. I quite like teaching, and I used to teach adults. I learned more from them than they learned from me. I'm certain any adult teacher will say the same thing, especially the kind of men and women I had in my classes, who were extraordinary.
You don't like speaking?
No,
I think many people would regard you as one of the great orators
people
the
are very,
80s and the 90s.
Very, very kind about that. And I know I've made some good and a few outstanding speeches. I know that. And I'm very fortunate that I've been able to articulate ideas, arguments. But I think anybody will tell you that my most fluent and effective speaking is done in a corner.
Well, let's just pause for a second, because we've got a clip of one of your most famous speeches. So let's have a look at that now.
If Margaret Thatcher wins on Thursday, I warn you not to be ordinary. I warn you not to be young. I warn you not to fall ill. And I warn you not to grow old.
Now, if people hadn't heard of Neil Kinnock before you made that speech, they'd certainly heard about you afterwards. That brought you to the attention. It was just a few hours before the election. Mm. Is that something that you'd worked on for a long time, that speech?
No. Glenys comes into the picture again. It was the Tuesday before the election, and I was due to speak in Bridgend in South Wales. But I'd been campaigning in London and the home counties, And so the only way for me to get to South Wales was for Glenys to drive me down while I worked in the back of the car. And very unusually, I think it was the only speech, maybe one other, that I wrote during that election campaign. And I sat in the back of the car with a clipboard and drafted the speech. And I'd been working on it for about 20 minutes. And I said to Glenys, what do you think of this? And I sort of read it and she said, sounds like blank verse. So I then wrote the rest of it in blank verse. And it's become known as the I Warn You speech. The tragedy is, of course, that so much of it came true.
And do you think you would have become Labour leader just later if you hadn't made that speech?
Yes, I think so, because I'd been very active in the trade union and Labour movement in a variety of ways for the 13 years that I'd been a Member of Parliament. And I had a degree of respect, even amongst my opponents, because I always tried to play straight with people, always have. And I could tell a joke, and I could turn quite grim situations with a sense of humour, which is also appreciated. Really, given the state of the Labour Party in the wake of the 1983 general election, the movement generally was looking for a leader who was unquestionably from the left, but sane and sensible. And I'd taken on Tony Benn and his element in the Labour Party, and people say denied him the deputy leadership of the party by organising the abstention of Tribune, as I say, Bevanite members of Parliament, in his bid to be elected deputy leader in 1981. And Dennis Healy won by 0.6%. I was sitting there on the platform waiting for the result, and I thought, you clown, why didn't you vote for Dennis? You disagree with him, but the party's in safe hands with Dennis Healy. It'll be wrecked if Tony gets elected. Much as in some ways I admired Tony, I thought that his brand of ultra-leftism was toxic for the standing of the Labour Party. And anyway, as it happened, I didn't have cause for regret because Dennis did win. But taking him on got me unintentional notoriety in some quarters and applause in others.
Do you enjoy campaigning? Do you enjoy a political campaign?
Yes. First of all, in terms of the opportunity of encouraging and inspiring our side, which is vital. It's part of leadership, I guess. But also in the opportunity to confront the enemy and to do it in the circumstances of election, when you don't have to take refuge in the night or the formalities. Of course, you must always try to be courteous. But if attacked, you hit back. And I used to get attacked a fair amount, so I always did hit back. And it's rambunctious. It isn't the definition of democracy, but without it, democracy is much weaker, much poorer, much less vibrant, less meaningful to a lot of people. People look for contest, sincere, authentic contest, not a put-up show.
A year after you became leader, we had the miners' strike in 1984, a very bitter industrial dispute, and you found yourself at the heart of it because one of the big arguments about that was the whole issue of whether or not the union, the National Union of Mine Workers, should have held a ballot or not. That put you at odds with the leader of the union, Arthur Scargill, didn't it?
Without reservation, I supported the case for coal. Not only on the grounds of maintaining the industry and the communities dependent upon it, but on grounds of national interest, because we were still then heavily dependent on coal and, by definition, domestically, coal and energy is much more secure than dependence on imports. So I wholeheartedly had always and did support the case for coal. And the first conversation I had about it with Scargill in October 1983, just weeks after I was elected as leader of the Labour Party, was satisfactory because he appeared to agree with the view that I expressed, that we had to uphold the case for coal, we had to contest a closure programme, and we had to do it by ensuring that men came off the coal field and went to communities around the country, market towns, London suburbs, and explained why it was a matter of the national interest to sustain the coal mining industry. Not every last bit, but nevertheless, substantially. And to invest in it and exploit Britain's massive, still massive, coal reserves. But then came the work to rule mining industry, which again I endorsed as a way of demonstrating the need for an intelligent investment program. And of course, the men in my constituency, I had over 4,000 miners in my constituency, were part of that. And they took wage cuts, sacrifices in doing that. So that when, by a series of ridiculous errors, the board gave the appearance of closing a colliery, an English colliery, Cottonwood, which proved to be erroneous. And the rolling strike started with men just stopping going into the pit and the South Wales miners going to different coal fields, to the canteens, and making the argument with the men that they had to fight to sustain the industry and their communities. It accumulated. And by the Easter of 1984, lots of people, including myself, and indeed including Mick McGaughey, the vice president of the NUM, who was a dear, dear comrade of mine, had been for decades, thought that the reason for convening a special conference of the mine, change the rule on the strike procedure, which was being sensible, and then have a ballot for the strike, following the precedent on every occasion on which there'd been a dispute in the coal mining industry in the 20th century. And that wasn't Scargill's thought. He actually thought that he could, by a kind of syndicalist insurrection, win the strike. And I knew immediately that was supreme folly, not least because the government had, with great care and in detail, prepared for the strike with huge stockpiles, vastly in excess of what the usual stockpile was, and lots of other developments, including social security powers and so on. So I knew that it was utter folly not to have the ballot and gain a democratic mandate for the strike. It was guaranteed to divide the labour force, which it did, and divided labour force in that industry, or indeed any industry, was doomed to failure. And the loyalty of the miners to Arthur Scargill was hideously exploited. It came dreadful misery, desperate poverty for a lot of the coal mining communities, where people lived literally on the charitable efforts of the rest of the trade union movement, the Labour Party, generous communities, foreign mining communities, and that isn't how those men and women wanted to live. But they sustained the strike, and my constituency, the men in my constituency, were first out and last back, as I would have expected. They are incomparable. As the strike wore on and the bitterness increased and the poverty deepened, I was determined that Scargill would never be able to use me as an excuse, or the Labour Party as an excuse for the failure of the strike. I was determined that the full blame would be where it belonged, and that was him. Not on the miners' executive, who were kept in the dark for much of the dispute, or on the miners themselves, who were stalwart to a superhuman level, and their families and wives were extraordinary. I was determined that he would historically carry the blame, and that's pretty much, except for his closest adherence, is what's happened. I took no pleasure in it, but I wanted to see justice done.
Now, the 1980s were a tumultuous time in British politics, and one of the things you were trying to do was to change the Labour Party. And, of course, in 1985, and we're going to hear it in a minute, you made another very famous speech about militant tendency.
I'll tell you what happens with impossible promises. You start with far-fetched resolutions. They're then pickled into a rigid dogma, a code. And you go through the years sticking to that, outdated, misplaced, irrelevant to the real needs, and you end in the grotesque chaos of a Labour council, hiring taxis to scuttle around a city, handing out redundancy notices to its own workers.
And we saw there Derek Hatton, who was technically the deputy leader of the council, heckling you. Another Liverpool politician, the Liverpool MP, Eric Heffer, he walked out, didn't he? I mean, what did it feel like when you're making a speech like that, of such force and with such a reaction?
I think you, if I'm honest with myself, derive a certain degree of stimulus from, if you like, rhetorically fixing your bayonet and charging. And I also felt a sense of relief because I'd wanted to make this speech the year before, but the year before was the middle of the miners' strike. And I knew that with all of the swirling emotions of solidarity and the inclination towards ultra-leftism and the war against Thatcherism, I never would have got a hearing. And it was vital for me to deliver that message directly to the Labour movement, if you like, between its eyes, knowing that the Liverpool militants were there. And so I really didn't give it to it. What I wanted to do was to expose and destroy them and make whatever contribution I could to saving the city of Liverpool from the abyss into which it would have been plunged with a continuation of their policies.
We said at the beginning that you were a man of the left. I guess you probably still say that you're a man of the left.
I am, yeah.
But you were certainly more left-wing than, say, James Callaghan or Harold Wilson. And yet, you moved to this stage in your leadership where you were talking about things like common sense and realism. It didn't sound very ideological then.
Well, I've always done that, though, you see. We talked earlier about the way I was brought up and the values, political and other values, that I imbibed without consciously doing so. And that was there all the time. If it doesn't work, it's no good to working class people. I mean, and you can enchant people by ideological flights of fancy, but that's not going to help them at all. And the to that was the man that I consider to be my lodestar, and that's Nye Bevan. Bevan, the father of the National Health Service, which he based on a working model that they had through the collective provision of quality health care paid for by tiny contributions by all the workers in Tredegar, the town that I came from, that showed that socialism had to work in practice, or it was a decoration, and being a socialist was nothing better than a hobby. And to me, it's still the way.
Isn't that
to
one of the
emancipate the
Sorry,
world?
Do you anticipate that the next generation of leaders would be more technocratic, would be a bit more like New Labour became?
I mean,
obviously, you were hoping for Neil Kinnock to be in number 10, not for somebody else.
Sure.
But was your vision of the Labour Party in the future that it would be a more technocratic party?
I was ecstatic when the Labour Party, first of all under John Smith, who tragically died, and then Blair, went from strength to strength. I think the problem was that despite great talent in that government, I mean, seriously, profound talent, and certainly a sense of progressive, decent and patriotic mission, they allowed themselves to lose impetus because Piedmont has once said that socialism is like a bicycle. If it doesn't go forward, it falls over. It's a very basic analogy, but it is entirely appropriate. And I understand the pressures and the distractions and indeed the temptations in some ways. But in the very frequent conversations I had with Tony, and he was always immensely generous with his time, as was Gordon Brown, I tried to get that across. And I would simply get agreement. And there's nothing more infuriating than getting agreement and then no action. And I think that's what happened. And it meant that very gradually, that breadth of appeal, which social democracy, democratic socialism, new labour, I don't give a damn about the label on it, real momentum. Underneath it all, the confidence was declining. And I greatly, greatly regret that, because these were good, talented people with a noble cause. And the only way to do it to its full extent is to maintain the momentum.
Now, you've talked about some big figures, Nye Bevan, Michael Foote, Tony Benn, Dennis Healey. One of the biggest figures of the 20th century was Margaret Thatcher. You faced her against the dispatch box.
Yes.
What was she like as an opponent?
It wasn't easy. She was a woman of distinction. She was 17 years older than I am. And I don't know if it was my upbringing or innate courteous deference or whatever else. I don't know. I'm making no excuses. These are just realities. I could never really tackle her in the way in which I was able to tackle, for instance, John Major, a man of same age, same kind of background. And I could be as relentless as I liked with him. If I misjudged it with Margaret Thatcher and even managed to land a blow, the consequences would not be full credit against a woman who, without exaggeration, as you will probably know yourself because you were around at the time, was profoundly hated amongst many people and in large part of the country. Certainly as hated as she was in other parts of the country, admired. The reality is that I didn't sort of consciously sit down and think that I should be reserved in my attack, but I knew that in my choice of language and in my choice of targets, I had to take a degree of care. Mrs. Thatcher would, I think, often for self-defensive reasons, seize upon a maxim and make it an ideology. I mean, Thatcherism emerged in that way. It wasn't an ism until pretty much around the time of the Falklands War, when Britain was making a no light recovery from the devastation wrought by the misplaced policies of she and Geoffrey Howe. Lovely man he was, but nevertheless he was wrong. In 79 and 80, when 25% of British manufacturing capacity was eradicated. And it took quite a time to that recover, but it was starting to recover, and the newspapers started speaking of Thatcherism. And I think Mrs. Thatcher inhaled, and eventually, of course, it brought a downfall.
So she was replaced by John Major, and so you're fighting the 1992 election against him. In many ways, you're both similar sort of campaigners. John Major would take to his soapbox. You always seem very happy when you're wandering along streets or popping into cafes and talking to people in the pub. Was it an old-fashioned campaign, do you think? Was it perhaps the last old-fashioned election campaign we've had?
No, in both the 87 and 92 elections, people said if it had been judged on the campaigns, you won. And we were good. I mean, we were very professional, but we also had vigour and we had a sense of belief. And that carried us more in 87 when we were really up against it. And we had to stop being third in that election, which we succeeded in doing. And in 92, we were very good too, even more professional. Now, along comes John Major, and he's a kid from an even more difficult background. Well, my background wasn't difficult. My background was wonderful. But he had a difficult background. And he won his way through the ranks of the Tory party. And in desperation, because the wheels were coming off their campaign, he literally pulled out an orange box or whatever it was from the boot of his coach and got a bullhorn and did what he'd done on the streets 25 years before. So people looking for the big change from Thatcherism, were presented not just with somebody who manifestly wasn't Margaret Thatcher, but with a guy who was proving by his very physical existentation that the great change had come. So that the people who wanted to vote for the big change could vote for the change and continue to vote Conservative.
You didn't win. How did it feel in those hours after defeat?
Deep bone marrow disappointment. But here's the extraordinary thing. This is what happens at times when people grieve. The distraction of being absolutely preoccupied with trying to help the people who'd given me their lives in my staff with their future meant that months passed before I sort of woke up one morning and thought, oh, what about losing that election, you know? And then I gave way for a week or so, it certainly wasn't more than that, to attempts at self-consolation, assisted by Glenys. But that didn't last long because the water had flowed. And the courteous John Major's phrase, and I was just grateful that that preoccupation had made my life much too busy and too concerned to be bothered much about losing the election.
You were joking earlier, before we started, that your time as Labour leader had been your midlife crisis.
Yes. Not many people can date their midlife crisis with precision. Mine started on October the 2nd, 1983, and it ended on July the 18th, 1992.
But since then, you've been a European Commissioner. You're now a member of the House of Lords. Mm. Did you enjoy your time in Europe?
Short of another ice age, I was born, brought up, and have always lived in Europe because that's where the UK is. And Europe's had many reasons to be grateful for that and will continue to. Despite what happened in the referendum.
As a young man, you were very critical of the common market, as it was called.
Yeah.
So do you understand why people wanted to reject the European Union?
I understand why they accepted the absolutely false prospectus that was hurled at them over 30 years by newspapers and by some politicians and latterly by those who argued for the Leave campaign. I understand that. But the awful reality is that the people who will suffer most as a result of the dislocation and long-term uncertainty economically will be a lot of the people who voted to leave because they were taught to become obsessed with immigration, particularly in areas where there is no immigration to speak of. I'm actually still devastated by the outcome, not in personal terms. Dennis and I are in our 70s. Our children are successful. Our grandchildren are bright and fit and will make their own way. That's all fine. But for our country, I grieve at the way in which this dislocation, this withdrawal took place for all the wrong reasons, and that's dreadful.
So at the end of this interview, we've spanned quite a long period of time from your beginnings in the valleys to life now. If you had that 15-year-old Neil Kinnock here, the boy who joined the Labour Party illegally, what would you say to him?
Carry on. Gird your loins. Sustain your beliefs. Work for enlightenment and emancipation. And that would sound a bit pompous, actually. I translated it in slightly different terms. I might say, don't ever think of a career in politics, because all the people that I've ever met who think of, who say to me, Ms. Kinnock, I'd like a career in politics, I say, don't! Because some of the biggest dolts that I've ever met, some of the most useless articles I've ever met, are people who've thought of a career in politics. It's not a career. It's that if you want to change the world and you've got the sense to organize for that, if you're very, very, very lucky, other people will put their trust in you and give you their vote. But never think of it as a career. And I might even say, no, I wouldn't. I was going to say, be a bit more cautious in your choice of causes and associates, because if you pick the wrong ones or they are a long way from convention, it'll come up to bite you. But I wouldn't. I think you've got to take some risks in any case and be true to yourself. I suppose if I had to use a phrase, it would be the one that my father used. Be true to yourself.
Neil, Lord Kinnock, thank you very much.
Thank you.